We'll look at stuff a little bit larger than that. And USDA will generally always go up to, I think the state limit is now $7.5 million, and the program limit is $10 million. There are special circumstances for, I think, exporters and different types of manufacturers will go up well above $10 million. But generally, you can think $500,000 to $10 million. If you've got a project in that realm, it could fit into a USDA scenario if it's in an eligible area. All right.
I'd like to talk a little bit about something that we're doing over at Summit Funding that might be interesting for some of you, and that is that we're helping a lot of people get their credit improved. A lot of our buyers are having challenges with credit, with their primary residence buyers or even investment property buyers, because the guidelines are so stringent nowadays on getting mortgages. Anybody who wants to loan money nowadays wants to make sure that the minimum credit scores are being achieved. Typically for a primary residence, the minimum credit score in today's environment is a 640 for a VA mortgage. It's a 620 for a USDA, and it's a 620 also for a VA mortgage. And that's probably going to be changing again, going up first of the year. So it just keeps getting tighter and tighter. For investment purchases, the minimum credit score is 720. And you get a break, you get a better rate, you get better options on your mortgage if you have a 740. So a lot of our investors have had challenges like everybody else has, and they're not able to get that score when they come in to see us the first time. We have a number of systems in place at Summit Funding where I work. All of us are credit specialists, where we can do a detailed analysis of your credit report and help you find ways to get your credit score up as quickly as possible. Sometimes we've been able to get people's credit score up to the minimum that they need in just a matter of weeks. Other times, it's taken over a year. It just really depends on the individual and how committed they are to getting that credit score up. But if that's a challenge for you, or if it's a challenge for somebody that you're trying to cut a deal with, I encourage you to have them give us a call, and we can do a quick credit analysis on them, and sometimes in just a matter of a few weeks, we can get them to that score that they need to achieve. We also have some printed material that we can offer to our prospects and our clients so that you can help them take action and work on getting those credit scores improved on their own. And keep in mind also that the free credit reports that you get from the internet are not the same as the credit report that you get from a mortgage company. A mortgage company's credit report is much more stringent. It's very likely you're going to have a lower credit score when you pull your credit from a mortgage company than when you pull it from a free credit report. But it's the mortgage credit pool that's going to determine whether you're going to be able to qualify for that mortgage. So if we can help you with that, let us know. Question?
Now, every time somebody runs a credit report, the points always goes down, correct?
Well, not necessarily always, but if you have a lot of pulls on your credit report, it's more likely that your score is going to be impacted negatively, yes. However, if you pull a mortgage credit report and you pull another mortgage credit report within 30 days, it's not going to impact it at all, because the credit bureaus are already set up to know that many times people, when they're shopping for a mortgage, they'll have it pulled by more than one lender. Uh-huh. So you have about a 30-day window that you get a free ride.
But after 30 days, you won't credit likely. But I already have credit report from somewhere else. Uh-huh. But it's a bank. Can I bring it to you? Can you just look at that, or do you have to run a credit report from that?
First thing I would do, and that's a great question, I would always ask you to bring your credit report with you so I can look at it. Because what we don't want to do is create any more problems for you by pulling another credit report right away. And a lot of times we can look at that credit report and give you guidance right away on what to do. And I'm going to give you guys two items that you can look at doing tonight without even having to call me or come to see me. One of the things I ask my clients is if they are on the do not call list. Are you familiar with the do not call list?
Yep.
Right? You get on that so that you don't get called during the dinner hour. And asked to buy solicitors, asking you to buy things. If you go on the internet to the Do Not Call registry and you register for that, you can add anywhere from 5 to 15 points to your credit score. Because the credit bureaus know that people that do that are more likely to avoid debt, right? Wow. And you're going to be avoiding pitches for sale. Do Not Call, go to the Do Not Call registry. You can find that on the internet. The second thing you can do, very similar,
is the opt-out registry.
Yeah.
You go on Google and you Google opt-out. That means that you're asking, you're registering your name and your address so that credit card companies will not be sending you free offers for credit cards. The credit reporting system knows that if you get on that opt-out, you're avoiding debt. You're avoiding the option to get into credit. There's another 5 to 10 points. So just imagine, if you're 10, 15, or 20 points away from meeting the score, that's a quick way to do it. You can do that in just a few weeks.
Yes. Peter, how long does it take once you opt out, once you do not call? You have to 30 days later to appear?
Approximately 30 days, you should see some impact on your credit. Now, keep in mind, if you're down in the 400s, you're probably not going to see a whole lot of
points isn't going to help.
But if you're at 618 and you need a 620 to do a mortgage, I'm sure at 619, you're still not going to get it. But if you're at a 618, that's a quick way to get some points. Same thing if you're an investor and you're at 700 and you need a 720 and you haven't done these things. I did this for a lady just before I got here tonight. She has a 714. She needs 6 more points. So she was very excited, and I was excited because I know that that's going to be a trigger. There are other triggers when I look at a credit report. I can look at a credit report for about 5 minutes. I can generally tell people a number of things that they can do to improve their credit without having to pay out a whole bunch of money. Sometimes it's moving balances from one to another. Sometimes it's closing accounts. Sometimes it's opening accounts. It varies from individual to individual. But I always encourage people who are not sure, don't do anything. Call me instead. Because I've had borrowers think that if they pay off and close a few accounts, that their credit's going to go up, and it actually goes down. The credit is funny. In fact, in the industry, a credit report is not known as a credit report. It's known as an opportunity report. Banks want an opportunity to loan money to people who are good opportunities to pay that money back. So there are a lot of things that make it seem to work backwards when you look at your credit. Sometimes more debt is better than less debt. I have clients come to me that say to me, my credit should be perfect. I don't owe anybody any money. Well, that's true. They have no credit. They have no history. And for a conventional mortgage, you need to have 3 open trade lines that have been active for the last 12 months. For a government mortgage like a USDA, VA, or FHA, you need at least 1 trade line and has to be active for at least 6 months. It has to be open. You have to be charging and paying on it. Okay. That, along with having a good credit score, a minimum score, again, 620 for a VA or a USDA, 640 for an FHA, and 720 for a conventional investor loan, essentially. Okay? Next thing I want to talk to you about is something that we've had a lot of questions about at our company over the course of the last year, and that's how long after a short sale or a foreclosure can I buy a home? And you get all sorts of responses. We get different responses depending on who we're talking to on any given day. But basically it's this, 3 years.
Yeah.
And you have to, after that short sale or foreclosure, you have to be an angel. No lates.
Yeah.
Right? Pay all the bills on time. You have to demonstrate that after that short sale or foreclosure, you did everything right. You always made those payments on time. If there's one late, there's a good chance you might need another year. It's going to depend on investor to investor. And we're a mortgage banker. We deal with a lot of banks. If you came to see me about a loan, I could take you all the way to the finish line, but I can choose from up to a dozen different banks that we have direct lines with in-house. Or I might broker it if it's an unusual circumstance. But every one of those investors is different, and they have different guidelines. And those guidelines change almost on a daily basis. So in 2 or 3 years, it might be different. It might only take a year and a half or 2 years, but as of today, it's 3 years of good behavior before you can qualify for a mortgage. I also had people saying to me, well, you know, my wife and I was the only one on the mortgage, right? Can she apply? Up until a month ago, the answer was no, because we're a community property state, and that means we have to run both credit reports.
Mm-hmm.
But some of our investors instituted some new guidelines about 30 days ago, and get this, we only have to run 1 credit report. So now, if spouse was not on the mortgage and the mortgage went into short sale or foreclosure, we can take an application from the spouse that was not on the mortgage. And if she can qualify, they can buy a home today. So that's something new that's taking place, and it's a great benefit. We're calling borrowers that we said no to over 30 days ago to come back in to see us now. So think about that. As you're looking to sell your property, I know a lot of your buyers have challenges with their credit. They've had a short sale, they've had a foreclosure. They've got challenges in their life like everybody does nowadays. But one of the things we work at really hard at our company is to be creative in finding solutions for our buyers. We don't deal with short sales because we don't service loans. We only arrange for people to buy loans. So that's all we focus on. So when somebody needs credit repair, when somebody needs a creative solution to their buying of investment property or primary residences, we don't stop until we find a solution. Or we can point them in the direction to get a solution down the road. So again, if anybody has any help or if you know somebody that needs help getting a mortgage, I've got some business cards here. And on the front of our flyer is my business card as well. You can get a hold of me there. And if you look in this month's Homes and Land magazine, like it's there every month, there's a quarter page ad about our radio program. And Jerry and I are on the show almost every week. I'm on the show every week with different guests. Some of you in here have been my guests in the past. Sasha, Alexander Cleary has been on our radio show. Michael Roop has been on our radio show. Ron Bell has been on our radio show. And the next person is going to be on our radio show. If you'd like to come on our radio show and talk to us about your property, investments, anything of that type, we're always looking for new guests. Yes, there's another guest back here.
Christina.
Christina Dumbavari was a guest. She's been on our show a number of times. And we enjoy talking to people and giving good information to our listeners. And believe it or not, many times after the show, the telephone starts to ring. And I get people wanting to know about the guest that I have. Or they might want to ask me a question or two about a mortgage. And before you know it, they're in my office talking to me about doing some business. So being on the radio has been a great help for my business and for many of our guests. And I encourage you all to tune in as well.
And that's on 1270 AM, is it?
We're on 99.1 FM on Sunday mornings at 9 AM. Real Estate Church.
And it's all on his website, too. He archives everything on the website, so that's really cool.
Can you repeat that again?
Yeah. It's at 99.1 FM Talk, and it's on the back of my business card, by the way. Do you have my business card? Just look at the back. I've got more of them up here. 99.1 FM on Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. Yes, sir.
Yield spread premium.
Yield spread premium is a way that the bankers make our money. So when we do a mortgage loan, let's take an FHA for example. If we charge, pick a rate, whatever the rate is, at 4.5%, through the mechanism of the banking system, after we cover our costs and do this loan, the banks upstream, in this case it may be Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac, they pay the bank, our company, a percentage. Let's say it's 1% or 1.5% of that mortgage. Essentially, we're paid a little extra to do that loan by the upstream bank. Because of that, we're able to either take that money and use it as income, or we can offer lower rates knowing that that yield spread premium is there as well. As a bank, if you go to Wells Fargo and you do a loan there, or you go to B of A, or you come to us, in fact, when we do your good faith estimate, we are not required to show that yield spread premium on there. However, if you go to a broker, straight broker that does not work for a bank, they're required by law to show what that yield spread premium is because we're required to show all of our clients essentially how much money we're making on that loan. And so it's known in the industry as YSP. A lot of banks don't pay their lenders, their mortgage originators, any percentage of the yield spread premium. I used to work for Wells Fargo, that's where I started my career. And they pay a